can't tell. Mix a special brew with fire inside of you. Anytime you feel danger or fear, then instantly I will appear. I'm every woman. It's all in me. Anything you want done, baby, I do it naturally. Oh, 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 oh. Oh, I can set your needs like rain unto the sea.
Hello?
To come in, so welcome everyone.
Okay, I'm still dancing.
Hello. Hello, hello, everybody. I think we have a good amount of ladies right now. So, wow, welcome to another installment of Women Making It Work. Thank you for that great music, Norma. It was a great way to wake us up if we're not already awake. For you guys that are familiar with this group, you know, we relaunched it earlier this year as part of the Hallandale Beach Chamber of Commerce. And when everything happened in March, you know, we had to regroup. We were planning on doing breakfasts, luncheons. We're gonna do all this nice activities. And we had the chief of police in line for Hallandale Beach, Sonia Quinones. We had like a great, like everything was set. Well, you know, keep planning ahead and then you'll have other things to do when reality strikes. So then we regrouped and said, why don't we just do the Zooms? Let's just use technology that we have right now. And I think, for those of you who have joined us, I think we've had magnificent ladies on this panel. They're all magnanimous. They're all amazing. They're all inspirational. So I'm so excited with today's guest. I'm your moderator, your chairperson, Carla Guadamuse Davis. And, you know, we all live here. We all live in South Florida. We all know about our healthcare facilities, hospitals. You know, especially if you're a parent, you want to know, where am I going to take my child if she or he gets sick, God forbid. If you've lived here for a while, you know about Joe DiMaggio Children's Hospital in Hollywood. It's one of the region's leading pediatric hospitals. It was established in 1992, and back then it was the first pediatric hospital in Broward County. And it is a facility of Memorial Healthcare System. So that is amazing. Joe DiMaggio Children's Hospital combines advanced technology and the expertise of the largest, most diverse group of board-certified pediatric specialists in our region. Joe DiMaggio Hospital now has 226 beds and is South Florida's newest freestanding children's hospital. And among some of the accolades and awards that this local hospital has earned, Best Children's Hospital in Orthopedics, Favorite Pediatric ER, Best Hospital Pediatrics in Broward County. I can go on, there was a lot on the list. Believe it or not, the person on top, the person in charge, the person who runs Joe DiMaggio Children's Hospital is this lovely, beautiful woman named Caitlin Stella. And she's the CEO. She's the one in charge. She was brought here to us, to South Florida, thank goodness, by Memorial Healthcare System to run this amazing children's hospital. And Caitlin, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Well, I have to first start by saying I do not run the place alone. thank goodness. We do everything in healthcare and especially at Joe DiMaggio as a team. And I have an awesome team of people that are, they are really the one. I work for them. I just make sure they have what they need that so they can do their jobs. And that's really how I view things. So
the quality of a great leader is to be humble. So you are that. Narupa, who actually works for Memorial Healthcare System, she's been very active with the women in business. She said to us in one of our last meetings, who do you guys have coming up? And we're like, oh, we're still, you know, we're always gathering lists and trying to get ladies in. She goes, well, why don't you guys invite Caitlin Stella? She's amazing. You know, we see her walking around the hospital. You're like walking around the hospital, helping out, doing this, doing like you're active, sitting in your CEO office, you know, where no one can see you. And that's what attracted us to invite you, because she said, she's out and about. She's very approachable. She's there. She's getting her hands dirty. So, you know, what else could we do but invite you to join us?
Oh, you're very kind. Well, it's funny you say that. I don't have an office right now because we are doing construction. I think if anybody's been in the area, we're adding four stories to the children's hospital. And the second floor, we're actually putting in a piece of equipment that's like the coolest thing. It's an interoperative MRI, which is like an MRI that runs while they're doing surgery on your child. So they can see real-time imaging and have the most accurate and precise incisions and things like that. So it's a very expensive piece of equipment, but I gave up my office to put it in there.
Wow. I don't know about too many. Yeah, I don't know about too many CEOs that would do that. And you're, I mean, that just even says more about you, that you're willing to go wherever to make things happen.
Well, you know, a little bit, when I tell you my story, it'll kind of make sense because I started my career as a volunteer. And, you know, I was in a hospital, an adult hospital for a very short period of time before I went to the children's hospital. And that is when I knew, I was 15. I knew, I was like, I don't know how I'm going to get back here, but I'm going to work in a children's hospital. And so for me, when you're a volunteer, you do whatever has to get done. You know, if you need to push a wheelchair, you push a wheelchair. If you need to deliver books or toys, you deliver books or toys. If somebody is alone, like we, you know, I've walked the hospital sometimes doing rounds and I see some of the babies or kids alone in their room. And as long as they're allowed to have people in the room, because sometimes with infection control and things like that, but as long as they're allowed to have company, you know, you want to go in there and like read a book or like play with some toys, you know, that's what we did as volunteers. And that's kind of how I see myself still. I don't think it changed. So.
Oh, please. Okay. You're just too kind. I'm gonna blow you up if you don't do it yourself. Honestly, you have to understand, you have shattered some major glass ceilings, because if you do some research and see the ratio, there are many women in the healthcare hospital industries, yes. However, as far as having women at the top of that food chain, it's very little. It's still, from what I read, anywhere between 10 to 13%. That is still super low. So oh my gosh, like I want to grab you and hug you right now if I could, because what you have done, what you're doing to represent women, to represent us in this position, you have a powerful position, even though you handle it extremely humbly and well. I mean, I don't know if I was in your position, I'll be like, yeah, I'm the CEO. And no, but you're just like, I love your attitude and how you're handling it. But in all honesty, how did you manage to break all those glass ceilings and go up that ladder? How did you do it?
I always like to give my first credit to coffee. No, I have to tell you, I grew up in a family business, and my grandparents, who were immigrants, came to the U.S., started a business together. You know, they were married for a while before they decided they were going to go for it and start this company in the 30s, 40s. And they ran it together. So my grandfather was like, you know, technically in charge, but my grandmother was really in charge, you know, and I worked for them. They were my first management team. And, you know, the business is actually, so it's a nursery, a plant nursery. And then we had a large landscape contracting company. So we did a lot of big jobs like the hospitals and the hotels and things like that in my hometown, which is Pittsburgh. And so I think what I learned from my grandmother was that, she was in charge of a large part of the business. In fact, you know, my grandfather would defer to her for decision-making all the time because, you know, women have a very different way of doing business. You know, she knew every single one of our customers and every one of our, you know, accounts, and she had a much more intuitive kind of approach, and he was more like all transactional business, and he knew his weakness was more people. I mean, he was great with people, but he didn't remember all the birthdays and all the kids' names and who was going to school. And, you know, my grandmother was the one that remembered to send you flowers if there was a death in your family or whatever. So they had this balance where I grew up seeing that, you know, women had a place at the table. That's what I would say, because my grandfather included her as a teammate. And so I think, you know, Ruth Bader Ginsburg just passed away, and she has a very famous quote that someone gave me on a coffee mug last week that says, "Women belong anywhere decisions are being made." And I think I grew up knowing that, you know, as long as you have a voice, you have a place at the table. And so I never really looked at it as anything more than, that was my earliest example, you know. And then through my whole career, as I went to school and as I went to undergrad and graduate school and got my first job, I always had really good mentors and examples, men and women, you know. So I had plenty of men in my career that opened doors to say, you can do that. You can do that. Anybody can do that. So I had that. And then I had a lot of women that were good examples of people that were able to show me that it was possible. So I was never really intimidated by it, because I felt like, as long as you're, you know, doing what you love and you're good at what you do, that you're always going to have a place at the table. And so I think that that's kind of how I even view things now. You know, I don't really see it as only a gender issue. I think it's really important to be that example for girls and boys, young children now, you know, and keep giving those opportunities and paying it forward and believing that, you know, everybody should have those opportunities. So, you know, I think that's part of the way I think of things.
Well, I've interviewed other female CEOs, and one of them was, she just left from AutoNation, and you kind of are saying similar things she said. It wasn't like she had a chip on her shoulder and thought, well, I'm a woman, I'm going to go do this because I'm a woman. You just do your best, keep your head up, stay positive. And whether you're a woman, whether you're Latina, whether you're whatever, it's not going to matter, because you're going to make and pave that way for yourself. Is that?
Maya Angelou, I hate using other people's words all the time, but Maya Angelou, I think, has a quote that says, do something so well that they can't take their eyes off of you. And I think that's a good way to think of it, because if you're really passionate about what you do, like, I love my work. Like, anybody will tell you that it is not a job for me. It is just, I feel like I'm still a hospital volunteer that's 15 years old, and I'm just now in a different, I have more responsibility.
So What's the biggest challenge since you've been here now 3 years? And do you like South Florida? Do you love our amazing multicultural world that we live in?
I love it. Well, my husband grew up here. He's a native of Fort Lauderdale.
Wow.
And we met in Los Angeles. So that's, you know, I've always been in a kind of an environment with a lot of diversity and action, and I love that. And so even though I'm from Pittsburgh, I ended up out there to go to school. And so we moved back here, and I love this community. I'll tell you what I love the most is the people. I mean, the people are so supportive, especially of the Children's Hospital. There's nowhere that I go that people don't say, Joe DiMaggio saved my child, Joe DiMaggio saved, you know, or I took my child there, I had a great experience, like anything I can do for you. That's always what they say. Like, what can I do to help the hospital? And even if it's something small, I'm so impressed with how supportive this community is. So I absolutely love it.
So what has been, I mean, I'm sure we're all having challenges now, but what would you say has been the biggest challenge that you've encountered while being here and running and co-running Joe DiMaggio Children's Hospital?
Well, certainly going through our first global pandemic, I would say, you know, everybody's first global pandemic. I feel like we should all have, you know, when babies get that t-shirt, like my first Christmas or my first Hanukkah, we should have my first global pandemic for every hospital CEO. This was very much like not what anybody expected. Like we study this in school. We understand what we're supposed to prepare for. We are prepared for things to an extent. But then anytime something like this happens, you really never know what you're getting, you know? Like the same thing happened when we had SARS and MERS and all those things where, you know, you don't know exactly what the disease is gonna do. We were hopeful that it was gonna be kind of like those and be very contained, but you never really know. So I think this has been a challenge for us because it's been a marathon. Like, it's not like flu season that comes and goes. It's been continuous. And so our teams are very tired. We're very tired. There's been a lot of stress, many, many unknowns, many changing rules. The community is stressed. You know, people coming to us are stressed. There's been a lot of sorrow and loss. And then on top of that, we've had a lot of, you know, social unrest with things that have happened in our community also. So it's just been this whole period of time with all of this, I would say, just endless amounts of stress of one form or the other has been hard to lead through because, you know, our job is to keep people's spirits up and keep them motivated and keep them, you know, coming to work and feeling a part of it and giving them what they need. And you have to fill your own bucket sometimes to be able to give them what they need too. So I think it's been a hard challenge for us as leaders to really understand not only not knowing what this, you know, disease is going to look like and what we need to do, but then also to keep our teams going, you know, it's been exhausting.
So I can imagine it must be, you know, communication is the key. So when something changes, like within the state, when something new happens, like with the governor announcing, we're going to open up, it'd be, you know, I'm sure you guys probably said, okay, we'll be prepared just in case. We hope it doesn't. We know schools are preparing to open soon in a half motto. So like my daughter is in school, but she's next door in the conference room on her Zoom. She will stay there for the whole fifth grade. Other parents, you know, need to have their kids in brick and mortar. So everybody's situation is different. So now we are going to have school starting again. You know, you don't want to be negative or the Debbie Downer, but you have to be realistic in your, especially in your field. So are you guys preparing if something does happen now that schools are opening?
Oh, yes. And on top of that, we're preparing for traditional flu season, you know, so we always plan for flu season every year and we're in it, we're getting into it October through April. So this year is going to be additionally challenging because we don't really know, like we're planning on having COVID patients, non-COVID patients, flu patients, patients that have COVID and flu. I mean, that could happen, you know, so We're preparing for a variety of different scenarios and just hoping that the community continues to follow the guidelines and therefore, you know, doesn't stress the system. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty. I just think that not only is communication the key, and I think the team, because like I said, I rely very heavily on my team and putting our heads together to say like, all right, like, is this the best course of action? And we include a lot of our leaders to like, you know, I kind of have this philosophy, like no decision about me without me. So when it impacts my area, I want to have a say. So we ask a lot of our department leaders, people who run our nursing units, imaging lab, we ask them to participate in the decision-making because we don't exactly know. And I'd rather them be part of it early. And then if we have to change course, they're helping us to say, hey, we're seeing this pattern. Can we make a change? You know, it shouldn't be coming from me. It should be coming from the people who do the work, you know? So that's kind of been the way we've handled things, which I think has gone a long way because people then feel very empowered to, you know, manage their areas the way they think is best for patient care.
You know, and you brought up a good point that because of who would have ever thought we would have said our first pandemic, that's something that you see in the movies that you think, oh, it's not going to happen now. And then here we are. So you personally, you're married. We won't say your age, but you're young. You don't, you know, you look good. I'm going to say
thank you.
40s. I'm not going to go in the 50. So you're a young woman. You are married. You're trying to do everything. How has this affected you on a personal level?
Oh yeah. I mean, look, I think any of us, and I bet you if I asked you all there's enough of you on video. If you have ever struggled with work-life balance, raise your hand. I mean, there's no such thing, right? I mean, to me, I just call it balance. It's just life, you know, and some days you're all there and you're firing on all cylinders. And some days you're like wiped out and you rely on other people to pick you up. And you know, whether that's at home, like my husband's a big support for me, you know, so like he's the person, I just said this the other day, I was telling someone, my husband takes me for a walk at night like a dog. Like when I come home, he's like, all right, you're going outside to run around like a collie or something. And, you know, you have to have people in your life doing those things for you. Just like I have someone at work that always makes sure I eat lunch, like, cause you know, you just forget to take care of yourself sometimes. So I think that any of us on here, no matter what field we're in, whether we have children or not, depending on how you work, and I work a lot and I work with a lot of heart, you know, you hit those points where you need to be re-energized or you need to take a step back or you need to take a break and you rely on your support system to help fill you up. And that to me is my team at the hospital. And I have the best team ever. And they're so supportive and so dedicated. So I can ask any of them for anything, anytime. And then I've got my husband at home and my family. You know, I have 6 siblings of my own. I have all my nieces and nephews. I mean, when I want a distraction or need to see them or talk to them, I'm thankful for technology now, you know, because we have our iPhones and we can FaceTime and things like that. But that's where my energy comes back to me from. I get it from other people, you know? So, but we're all that way, you know, nobody's perfect and people struggle and anybody that says that they don't is lying. because we're just human and, you know, and some days are better than others, I feel like. So, and we've had moments in time during this whole pandemic where I have literally thought to myself, if one more thing happens, like, I just don't know if the team or the system or, you know, can handle it. But you have to remember, the human spirit is very, very strong. You know, we all have found it in ourselves at certain points in our life where we thought we were just beaten down, like we muster it up, you know? So I think that's what it's about. You pick each other up and on days where you're doing great, I'm not, and we hold each other, you know? And I feel like that's kind of the spirit at the hospital and at home for me too. On the days where I am like, oh my God, my husband's like, I got this, like, you know, don't worry. So I we're all that way, I think.
Yeah, and I don't think anyone's just joining us, but I'd like to just reiterate, Caitlin Stella, CEO of Joe DiMaggio's Children's Hospital, is our special guest today in the Women in Business Council, brought to you by the Hallandale Beach Chamber of Commerce. So, you know, Caitlin, we have ladies on this from all walks of life. I personally do real estate. Norma is the CEO of the Hallandale Beach Chamber. We have ladies here joining us from the hospital. I mean, everybody, my friend, Kyla Connie, my real estate attorney, she's here. We have so many magnificent women, new and some that I've seen before. We're all, like you said, we're all going, hey, Anna, my friend Anna is there. Everybody here, Rochelle's amazing too. Mayor Cooper, thanks for joining us, Mayor Cooper. You know, everybody here, do we have Randy Shane from Dania Beach Chamber of Commerce? I think she was gonna also join us and say hello. So we have some magnanimous, amazing women in our own right as well, and what we do in our own, you know, bubble. What can you give, if there's a recipe, I know everybody has their own. What would you say is your recipe? You've got to have one, and we're not going to share it with anyone else, just us.
So recipe for
success, just, for everything, okay. For balance, like what we okay, were just yes. talking about. What would you say is that thing?
Yes.
That okay. keeps you going?
First, let me tell you that I can ever support any of you. You know, I want you to tell me if there's a way to support you, because I feel like I know that about this community, that there's very strong leaders, men and women, but women have a different kind of way of networking. You know, I'm involved in a lot of networking groups for women, and I've always been in my career, and that's how it goes. You need something, you're going to help me. You need something from me, I'm going to help you. And like, I will put that out there as a permanent, no matter what. I give my cell phone to everybody, because I always say, if you know of a child coming to the hospital, I want to know, you know, because I will get my team on guard, you know, ready to go. And that's for anybody. I've had random people text me and they're like, you have no idea who I am. And I'm like, I don't care. Just give me your kid's name, you know? So anyway, I'll just put that out there. But my recipe, and I'm actually looking for my, oh, here it is. Hold on one second. Okay, this is my secret weapon. Okay, so we kind of made this a thing at the hospital, love Jodie, because I believe that the spirit of the hospital is very much about how much we love the kids. We all do. I mean, and anybody that's ever been there and you've brought your children there and maybe you've had experience with Lotsy Dotsy or the team or the physicians, everybody who comes through the doors at Jodie feels the love. Like there's just some phenomenon. It's like in the middle of our logo, right? But for me, the reason I say that's my secret sauce is because I think I work with a lot of it. Like I really genuinely love what we do for our families, even when they're going through the worst possible thing, we can always do something. And if we, that's why that feeling of still being like a volunteer, where if you need it, I'm going to drop everything and I'm going to help you. I mean, I've had literally I'm running to a meeting and I have a little kid in the lobby who's scared of getting a blood draw and they're crying. And I'm like, the meeting can wait. I'm going to go get him some toys or something, you know, comforting. And like, you know, cause that's why we're there. And I think we have to always remember that. And so I think for me, that's kind of what keeps me going. As long as I love what I do and I feel very much invested in an organization like we have, and we're so lucky to have this children's hospital here, because not all children's hospitals are the same. And the fact that every single kid, every single parent that comes through the doors is going to be treated like our own family members, I can tell you that. That's what we do. So to me, as long as we work with that love, that heart, we're always going to do well. We'll always figure it out. You'll always have your team by your side as long as you kind of work with that. That's kind of that's my recipe.
Well, I wish they would have had some of that last night at the debate. There wasn't. So
they needed a couple of like masks to sort of like, you know, like let each other actually get a word in, you know?
Exactly. Oh, right. I don't know if we want to get into that. I think
I know. I agree with you. Let's steer clear.
I was going to have my daughter watch it. She's 10 and I want her to know, understand certain things. But when I saw the first 10 minutes of it and she was kind of dozing off, I'm like, good, go to bed.
Because, you know, it's funny you say that. There were people afterwards commentating, and I kept switching. I don't really watch the news anymore. Like, I watch, like, BBC News, and I read NPR and PBS, but, like, I can't find, like, good news anymore, you know? Like, I mean, or like, good quality, I should say, you know? And I do, actually. I actually did an experiment. I would encourage you guys to do this because it's a fascinating experiment, okay? I used to have on my social media feeds, and I'm a social media person. I love posting stuff on there, especially about the hospital. And I took all the traditional news sites off my feeds, and then I replaced it with like 6 or 7 news sites that are positive. They're like good news sites. So they tell you the same news stories, but they give you the positive side of people like helping each other or... And it made a total difference in my mental status about what's happening in the world, because I think we're always so used to only seeing the negative, but there's, like Mr. Rogers always says, there's always a helper. There's, you got to look for the helpers, you know, and there's always people doing good. So you just have to find it. But if all you're hearing is negativity, that's all you think is happening. But there's so much good, and we all want to do good. I mean, I wake up every day trying to make the world a better place, and most of us do, you know, most of us are not trying to make it worse, you know, but that's the picture that's painted for us. So I actually, it totally changed my whole perspective, because I was getting some happier, not happy, but just positive versions of what was going on.
So what I'm gathering is try to stay as positive as you can.
Yeah.
Around, you know, around all the negativity that we, I don't think we've been surrounded by more negativity in our lives than now. And we're similar age groups. And so you have to create your own positivity. If not, you're going to be constantly barrage with all the negative stuff that's going on.
Yeah. And I think that, like, it's up to us. Like, the only thing we can control is our reaction to what happens, right? Some things happen and we have no control, but like, we can control how we react. And so I feel like for me, just to have that balance, and the moral of the story I was trying to say is that last night after the debates, there was commentating happening about how kids had seen that interaction. And this generation has grown up with learning about kindness, learning about generosity, learning about acceptance. Like, most kids, that was like, what is this, you know? And so it was interesting to hear parents talking about, like, the example that they saw by letting their kids watch last night. So it's just interesting, you know? I mean, I'm definitely of the thinking that we only have one life, you know, here that we know of, and we got to use all the time in it to do the most good we can. And, you know, some days we're going to do better than others, but in general, that's what I like to think of as my purpose.
And, you know, now volunteerism has taken a different look because of what we are going through. I know that there are obviously people that are still volunteering and, you know, wearing masks with shields and being extra careful. But at Joe DiMaggio's Children's Hospital, are you guys still actively working with volunteers?
Oh, yes. Now, the visitors, like the people that come in and do volunteer work, is very limited, but we're hoping that as, you know, we continue to see things improve over time, we'll keep assessing the right point in time that we can allow people in. But the volunteerism has not stopped. There's lots and lots of things that people are doing remotely. We have, I'll give you some examples. We have a great music therapy program, and we have people in the community who are recording music or playing virtually with our music therapists for our kids. We have stories being read to the kids from people outside. We have organizations doing fundraising and making book donations or art supply donations. We have all kinds of things happening. And as we get closer to the holidays, we'll be actually promoting some ways that people and organizations can get more involved. Because there's a lot of ways to support the kids at the hospital, even during this time.
Caitlin, we have a couple of questions, and one of them we just answered about volunteerism, and Casey put the website on the chat then there's another question that we have. Well, it's up to you. How do the ladies get in touch with you? Want to share email or something on the chat where we can, you know.
Yep.
Ladies, make sure you mention you were a part of this amazing program with the Hallandale Beach Chamber of Commerce, Women Making It Work, part of the Women in Business Council. So this is great. Thank you for sharing that. I didn't want to share anything that you didn't want to put up there.
No. Go for it. Contact me anytime. And yes, thank you, Casey, for sharing that. The volunteer website is up, but if we're also very open to creative ideas, like if we have something that an organization wants to do for us, we'll usually try to find a way if we can.
What would be the first thing that you would want to do once COVID is under control? What would you say is on that list of things that you would want to get done and do?
Well, I am determined. I don't know if COVID will be done because it's going to be a while, but I really want to get back to finding a safe way to resume some of the things we've always done for the kids at the hospital around the holidays. So like, for example, they get a lot of special visitors, like sports figures or, you know, singers or like things like that. And, it's hard to be in the hospital during that time of year, both for the patients and the parents. And so I'm kind of determined to find a way to safely come up with a way to have those same interactions happen, not only just in the holiday period, but ongoing. And Zoom is great. I mean, Zoom has been awesome. I mean, in all of these like WebEx, and it really has, but I feel like we should, you know, try. There's nothing that can really replace like human interaction, like me looking at you eye to eye, you know? And I think for the kids, especially when they're in the hospital right now, it's weird, you know, we're all in masks and shields and everything's covered and it just there's not a whole lot of warm fuzzy, but a great distraction of someone coming to visit you or like a great activity, you know, that I hope we can get back to that kind of thing. Like I keep calling it the regularly scheduled programming in the children's hospital. We're lucky that we do have a closed caption TV station. This is something I can actually say we are doing with volunteers also. We have a TV station so the kids can tune in from their rooms. And we have people who are like talented musicians and artists. We have someone who comes in and like paint by number and the kids paint in their room and they follow, you know, people that want to share their talents can come and do it that way. And then the kids can participate without being in a big group. We have a game show. So it's fun when like if somebody wanted to come and do an activity where they could win a prize, we deliver the prizes to the rooms. You know, we have people that go and do that. So, you know, we've been really trying to get creative in terms of engaging and keeping the kids entertained.
So is there like a studio that you guys have in the hospital, like a TV studio?
It is. It's like a TV studio, the green screen. And then we have Lottie Dotsie, who's our clown. I don't know if any of you guys know Lottie. She's not a clown. She is a clinician. She's a respiratory therapist and she's part of the care team. But she studied clowning actually when she was a respiratory therapist because she was trying to get kids to do breathing exercises. So she thought maybe using bubbles to blow or like a harmonica, you know, would help them with their lung development. So smart. So she went and studied clowning and now she's been an institution at the hospital forever. So we have Lotsy Dotsy story hour. She sits and reads books. We have a child life program. Yes, I see you. We have a child life program and they do medical play. So like they have different topics where like one day they'll talk about IVs and they use a teddy bear and they show the kids how it works and why you have to do it and why it's good for you. And it's explained for different age levels. So we have a really special place, honestly. That's why I said this community is very fortunate to have Joe DiMaggio, and just like we're fortunate to be the hospital, be the children's hospital. I think we're all very fortunate that we have it here and that it has such a warm culture and like the best group of people and clinicians. Can't say enough.
And if I'm not mistaken, I think we did like a multi-chamber networking event, Norm, if I'm not mistaken. We went there, we had that big room, and it was like speed dating, but for business. So I missed that. That was kind of fun. I remember that. I don't know, you guys are shaking your head, so you remember doing that. So I can't wait to go back and do that, because that was a lot of fun. We really, it was my first one a few years ago. I'm like, oh boy, what is this? But it was really fun. I got to meet a lot of cool people, and it opened, you know, your eyes that you can network quickly and everybody's busy. So it's really nice. Yeah. So I think we all miss some of that.
For sure.
Again, we still have all these amazing ladies. Oh, and some gentlemen, Jesus and John, you guys are awesome. And James, I love you guys for being on here. So here's what I want to get to. As I'm asking each question, I hope everyone's gathering some of what you're saying, Caitlin, because you're technically giving us your recipe every time you talk. So your positivity, your love of love, you know, and just moving forward without always having all these things bog you down is what I'm gathering, is what motivates you and is what makes you a leader as you are. What would you say are the things that tick you off?
Okay, here's a good one. So I am a big idea person, right? Because I feel like that's part of my job. I'm supposed to be thinking of like, what do kids need, right? So every day it's like, the kids in the community need that, right? And then it's like, well, we should be doing more. Like, let's think bigger, you know? And so one of my pet peeves is people that no matter what the idea is, their first reaction is no. Like, I am not a no person. I'm like a, well, maybe not right now. I'll take that. Or, we need to get, you know, we need to take some steps to get there, or let's talk about it. Let's think about it. But when someone just says no without completely understanding, I have a hard time with that, you know, because I'm like, how can you say no to such a great idea for kids, you know? So that's one of my pet peeves. I think the other frustration that I have is with, and I hope I don't offend anybody on here, is with sometimes in healthcare, we deal with insurance limitations for families that need things, you know, and we understand why, and getting the insurance company to get the child what they need sometimes takes a team of people working behind the scenes to pull it off, because the system, healthcare is a really cumbersome, weird system. If you don't speak the language or understand it or know how it works, it's very difficult. And so that's why I always tell people, just call me or email me, because something that I can do in 5 minutes would take you 2 weeks, you know, because there's a lot of like things that you have to sort of figure out. So that's another frustration for me, that I wish it was easier for kids to just have immediate access to the things that are really the best quality of care, not like the least expensive. But that's kind of what our healthcare in the US is set up. We're lucky that we have a good quality of care system in general compared to other countries, but it's not very easy to navigate. It really isn't. So that's why I always offer me, my team. In fact, when I came to Joe DiMaggio, I set up the one service I always wanted. So I came from UCLA. I was at UCLA Mattel Children's Hospital, same job. And then before that, I was at Children's Hospital Los Angeles. So I was in two big children's hospitals before this. And then I was a consultant. So I worked all over the country, and I know about a bunch of the children's hospitals. And I always said, if I'm going to get my own children's hospital to run, there's one service I'm going to set up, and it's going to be a concierge for everybody. Okay. So when I got to Joe D, that was my one pet project, where I set this thing up called, we call it our kidsierge. And the kidsierge can get you whatever you need, because if a family calls me on a Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock and their child is having severe XYZ, you know, or a pediatrician calls us and they say, this kid needs to be seen today, something's wrong. I have always learned in my career that if a parent or a pediatrician call a children's hospital with an urgent need, you act, you know, you don't say, we'll see you in 3 days. You say, just start driving, and by the time you get here, we'll figure it out. That's what I've learned. And I can tell many, many, many stories in my career where had we not done that, the child would have a bad outcome. So that's what I kind of tell my team. That's what we're going to do. We're going to serve all needs, you know? And so with my kid, Sierra, I can just punt to her and her team and say, help this family get in today. Or they're driving from Port St. Lucie. Let's get them in for all of their imaging and to see the doctor, because then they don't have to come back again. I mean, those are the kinds of things that without somebody behind the scenes to help you get it done, it's very, very difficult to do. So now we're able to do that for everybody. So it's like a dream come true that, you know, I think all of us, we've all been there as patients where you wish you could just call one person and say, can you just get me in for my mammogram and my other appointment on the same day so I can just take off work one time? And, you know, and it's just not the way it is. So.
Especially when you're dealing with children and you know, as parents, you want to get it done quickly. You don't want to be dealing with that whole red tape, and you want your child seen. You want to get it done. I think that's fabulous.
Exactly.
That you guys, I'm going to say Joe D from now on. Joe D Hospital has it. I'll be cool like you.
Love Joe D. See, that's why we have our
love everybody. Love Joe D.
Yes. that's our sign. Here, if you guys all flash your heart sign, I'm gonna take a picture of it. I put it in my newsletter.
Wait, okay. Not everybody's on camera. Hold on. Okay. We have James, Darlene, Judy, Elizabeth.
Okay, I see you.
I'm calling you guys out who's not on camera.
Right, 1, 2, 3. Let's put them up there. Yes, got them. Okay, cool. They're going to love that. Yes. I'll tell you a story. This is what taught me my lesson. Like, I always functioned this way, that if a family needed help, you just did it. But I remember very clearly, maybe about 10, 12 years ago, I was working at the Children's Hospital in LA, and this pediatrician called me, and it was somebody that didn't like the Children's Hospital. He was always like, you guys are too difficult, you can never get me in, and every time I call, I get put on hold, and I don't send my patients there anymore. And I remember talking to him one time, and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. But he called me, and he's like, I need a favor, there's a kid in my office who cannot see out of his left eye. He's about 3 years old, and he can't see out of his left eye suddenly. And I was like, oh my gosh. So I was like, this sounds terrible. And I said exactly what I said to you before. Just get the mom in the car, tell the parents to get in the car and just start driving. And by the time they get here, I'll figure out what to do, you know? And that's exactly what happened. And by the time they got to the hospital, we had some imaging done. And that kid had brain surgery in the afternoon to take out a tumor, a brain tumor, pushing on his eye, his optic nerve, that was massive. And malignant, and he was in chemotherapy and all this treatment and radiation. And I just always remember that, like, what if somebody would have made him wait a month? You know, what if somebody would have made him just go to the emergency room and sit there with all that stress of the parents? And it was like, that was like unfathomable to me that you would put a family through that, on top of like wondering why all of a sudden their three-year-old's falling over and he can't walk and he can't see, you know? So for me, that was the day that I was like, never again, never. I mean, we will always act, you know, no matter what.
Caitlin, you've now, like I said, been doing this for 3 years. What would you say is your five-year plan at Jody?
Oh, that's easy. Okay. So our five-year plan is essentially this, that we are so in healthcare, we have weird terms for everything, but so primary care, secondary care, tertiary care, quaternary care is how we kind of articulate the intensity of services. And Joe DiMaggio is a quaternary center. We do heart transplants, we do kidney transplants, we take care of kids with chronic healthcare needs, orthopedics. We are a quaternary center. We can do the highest level of care. So over the next 5 years, we are going to continue to build those very, very complex services for kids that require multiple specialists. We also have two of our programs nationally ranked through US News. One's a cardiac program and one is our orthopedics program, but we have three more that are right on the verge. So I think we're gonna be, you're gonna see us getting ranked in the future. But the biggest priority that we have and how we're gonna get there is to do what we've always done, which is focus on quality, safety, and a good patient experience, that patient family-centered experience where everybody feels loved, you know? So those three things are what's gonna get us where we're going. And so we're putting all of our eggs in the patient safety quality basket. And then we also continue to focus on making it just a great environment for our kids.
And I would call this probably the hardest question that I do have, because it is an important, serious issue. If Obamacare is repealed, if that happens, what is Jody doing to be able to service those children that are under that kind of plan?
Well, I will say the silver lining for children is that Medicaid will always exist and always covers kids. Or I should say, maybe it won't always exist, but it does. And it always covers children. So we, even though if Obamacare changes coverage for adults, children and pregnant women will still have coverage through Medicaid. So, and all children's hospitals across the country, including ours, are a minimum of 50% of our kids are covered by Medicaid and some form of state funding and programming, because most of the kids that use children's hospitals have very, you know, severe disease. So for me, I study more what's happening with Medicaid, because that's the majority of my kids. And so when I go to Washington every year, which I used to, this year we did it virtually, but we lobby to keep Medicaid funding for children and not make any changes around limitations of care. Because again, those issues with insurance is what drives me crazy. Because when kids have a need, you know, and parents have enough stress to begin with, it just makes it that much more difficult. So it'll be a little different for children no matter what happens.
So I'm going to give you my lightning round. So it'll be quick questions coming up. What keeps you up at night?
So I will say right now, I'm concerned about where we're heading with the flu season. And I really do hope that the community gets their flu shots if they can. There are people that can't get them, but majority of people can. So I hope you all get your flu shot. Because what it does is it lessens the risk. So anything we can do right now to lessen risk, I'm a fan of, because COVID's still unknown and flu season's a little unknown. So I think that keeps me up. The other thing that keeps me up at night, actually, believe it or not, or maybe you will, is I worry about the mental health of children. I do. I worry about the next generation of kids, how they're growing up, what they're seeing. I mean, I think back to your own childhood and what you were not exposed to and why you are the way you are as a person, because you weren't, you know? And I worry about, like, with this generation, I think we have some of the smartest, sweetest, I mean, some of these kids are just so, they're learning all these great values in school and at home, but then the world around them isn't like meeting that need. So I worry about that. And I see it sometimes in the hospital with kids coming in with like behavioral health issues, depression, anxiety, and I'm talking little kids, you know? So that is one of those things that as the children's hospital, we're actually becoming much more involved in the community. Like the mental health and behavioral health side of healthcare is like very near and dear to me. I kind of started my career in autism and, but I worry about being able to meet the needs of kids or fully understanding them, because not only do they have social media and they have this weird world with the news media, and like, they're not able to do what I'm doing, which is I'm sifting through, I'm filtering through things that I know are not accurate. They don't know, so they're taking in information. You know, my sister was telling me my niece is taking a class in school about how to find real news, like real information that's been validated and, you know, real journalism. And I thought to myself, That's great. But it's so sad to me that you have to take a class like that right now. Because like when we grew up, you know, you read the newspaper, you read a newspaper like the Washington Post or the New York Times or whatever, and you didn't think about it, whether or not it was real. You know, they're going to be, you know, more, oops, are you there? Are you guys there?
Yeah, we see you. We see you.
Okay, good. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. I don't know what happened with my computer. Anyway, that's what worries me at night. And then just to see those kids coming into the hospital with these mental health issues, that little kids, young kids, even adolescents, things that I can't imagine them experiencing is another thing that keeps me up at night. And it makes me want to work harder for the next generation. That's what it does for me. It's just motivation to do more.
That's awesome. So one word answers. Here we go. Favorite food?
Steak.
Favorite song?
I'm going to say Don't Stop Believing.
Favorite daily ritual?
Coffee.
Person you would like to meet?
I would say, good question. I'm going to go with Eleanor Roosevelt.
Wow. Person living that you would like to meet.
gosh, that's a tough one. I would say Bill Gates.
Good. Favorite website?
Yeah. Go ahead. What?
Favorite website?
Oh, Amazon.
Place that you would love to visit if you could travel right now?
I'd go to Australia.
Well, you know, we have 5 minutes left, and I just want to say that, you know, I think I can speak for all of us. I feel like we got to know you a whole lot better. And when do you get a CEO of a major hospital come and talk to little old us? So thank you, Caitlin Stella, for being
honestly,
here.
Honestly, you guys, keep in touch. Like, this is a very small community and we are in it together. So just please, you know, keep in touch. Let me know if I can ever support you all. I'm happy to do so.
Well,
so.
On a normal Women in Business Council, we would all say, hey, ladies, let's take a field trip to Joe DiMaggio. They're going to treat us to lunch and we're going to take a tour. Yeah. That's Sunday. What we would have normally done, but we can't. But we would love to go visit whenever it's safe. Yes. Because those are the things we were going to do as a group.
Yeah, we'd love to have you when the time comes. You're more than welcome. So in the meantime, you have my email, and thank you so much. Hi, Lisa. Okay.
So I want to just, ladies, while you're all here, this October coming up is a quite busy month for us. Next week, October 7th, we have a Fashionably Pink, raising awareness about breast cancer. We want to thank Memorial Breast Cancer Center for being the sponsor of that event. That's from 12 to 1. You'll get emails. Then we have Good Morning Hallandale Beach, October 22nd, talking with Commissioner Lena Taub. And I just want to say thank you, Caitlin Stella. We love you. Guys, can you get on the screen? And Norma's going to take a screenshot. And everybody, just who cares if you have a ponytail on? Just get on. Do the heart. And we're about to take a screenshot. Everybody, hang on. 5 more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2.
Thank you.
A singer in a snow cave.